Today we're going to cover gap staging and how it's a little bit different from direct staging.
Welcome to Advanced Construction Videos, where we show you how to tackle rocketry building techniques and more. On our website, we sell kits, motors, building supplies, and electronics. So come and learn, shop, build, and fly when you visit us at apogeerockets.com.
Now, direct staging has been involved in rocketry since the beginning. Since the early 1960s. It's where you take two rocket motors, you stack them one on top of each other, and the bottom motor ignites the top motor. Now the reason this happens is because the way the motors are made. In a booster motor, which is this one here, and it always ends with a zero on it, it has no clay cap and no delay charge in it. And what happens when the propellant reaches the end or the top of the rocket motor, it just fires forward. It can't hold the pressure and it pushes the remaining propellant and the hot gases forward. And that goes into the nozzle of the upper stage and it will ignite it. Now, when you do direct staging, what you want to do is actually tape the motors together. And when you tape them together, it's important to use cellophane tape. You don't want to use masking tape for this. You want to use cellophane. And the reason is that the cellophane, being a plastic, it melts really quick. So when the heat from the bottom motor goes up into the nozzle of the top stage, it's going to melt that plastic and they're just going to separate really quick. Now, that's direct staging. And what people have wanted to do is to separate the motors so that they're farther apart. So here, I've got kind of like a two-stage rocket. We've got a booster motor. Again, it ends in the zero. And then we have an upper stage motor. And these are going to be joined together, but there's a gap in there. And that's why we call it gap staging, because unlike this one, they're not in direct contact with each other. Now, there's a trick to doing gap staging. And that is you have to get the cold air out before the hot air is going to go in. So what does that mean? Imagine this is a two-stage rocket and we got fins attached down here and a fins attached up here. So this gap in here, this volume of air, it's already kind of cold. So when the ejection charge fires, it's going to push that cold air up into this top stage. And what happens with cold air? It's just going to be compressed. And when it's compressed, it's just going to create a lot of pressure on the inside. And that's going to try to push the top off. And so we need to relieve that pressure and get that cold air out so that the hot air can go up into the nozzle and ignite that upper stage. So the way we're going to do this is we're going to drill some holes in this booster stage tube right below the nozzle of the upper stage. So imagine here, I'm going to cut a hole there, maybe cut a hole here, another one here, and another one here. You probably want, it doesn't take, you know, a big hole, probably all told, maybe a quarter inch diameter hole. You know, if you're using multiple holes, just kind of reduce the diameter smaller. And what that allows is for that cold air to be pushed and it will come out of the holes so that the hot air can go up into the nozzle. And we do this a lot in a lot of rocket two-stage that we do here at Apogee. For example, here, I think this is the Midge. It has a gap staging and you'll notice that right here on the booster stage, there's a little bit of a hole, again, just to allow that air out so that the gases can go up into the top stage. This here is our latest kit. This is the Arc Stratus. And again, if we look down here, right there are the holes to allow the air out. Now, this is not a minimum diameter, so sometimes you have to have two holes. Let me show you our biggest one. This is the Aerodactyl rocket kit. And this is about as big as you can use for direct staging or indirect staging. And it's because this is the largest black powder motor that is available that will allow one motor to directly ignite the upper stage. Again, these have to be black powder motors. It does not work with composite motors. So in this one here, we have a lot of volume in here. So my holes are a little bit bigger to relieve that pressure. But sometimes you'll have a tube within the tube and you'll need holes both on the inside and the outside to make sure that you're venting that cold air. Make sure it gets out without it pushing those stages apart, prematurely. If you want to use composite motors, you have to use a different technique. It's called indirect staging. And that's where you're going to have electronics in the upper stage, which actually fires off the motor in the upper stage. That's completely independent of the booster stage. When the rockets get really big like this, the big problem is now you have this stage and it's big and heavy and it's got a big heavy motor casing in it. And they're going to tumble pretty fast. Ideally, what you want to do is to get some sort of recovery device in here besides just tumble recovery. And that will slow it down and prevent any kind of damage. So again, this is kind of like the biggest one you're going to do. If you want to have a recovery device on the inside, it is possible, but it's a little bit tricky. This is one of my daughter's competition rockets, and it's a two-stage rocket, and it uses direct staging. So the upper stage will be ignited by the booster motor. But on this one right here, we got a long tube on the inside, and that tube, it's free to slide. So what happens when the ejection charge goes off, it pushes that cold air out. Now you don't see any holes here. Then the reason is there's holes in the centering rings that allow that cold air that's being pushed forward to turn around and then actually come out the back of the rocket. So I am venting it, but it's coming out the back. But this motor tube on the inside is free to slide. So as it ignites the upper stage, you're going to get a little extra kick as this ignites, and that's going to push this motor tube out the back. And you can see down here on the bottom, I've just got a streamer wrapped around. I got a rubber band on it right now, but there's a streamer wrapped around that just unfurls, and then this allows this to, instead of streamlining into the ground, now I got a streamer on it, it unfurls, and it just flutters down to the ground. So that is one method. It's very tricky. You got to kind of play with it a little bit to make sure that you're igniting the motor and at the same time kicking the motor tube out the back so that you can release a recovery device. A question that people often have is how far apart can the motors be? What's the furthest distance that you can use, you know, that gap staging? I've done personally up to 18 inches. So that's, you know, like a full length of body tube. But I've heard online that some people have gone all the way up to 3 feet. Now, I don't know if I'd ever try it myself at 3 feet because you got to push, you know, that hot air all the way up to the top. That's a long distance, but it is possible that people have done it. But, you know, I would anywhere from up to about 10 inches, it's very reliable. Anything after that, it's getting a little bit marginal. So you better, you know, make sure that when you launch those rockets, everybody knows it's a heads up flight because we got to make sure that that upper stage does ignite. Otherwise, it could separate and then it's going to come down without any recovery device. So that's what we want to be careful of. Okay, one more thing on gap staging. This right here is the WAC Corporal, and this is a scale model. So in real life, it had a gap between the booster stage and the upper stage. Now in real life, they use indirect staging to ignite that upper stage. But this particular kit demonstrates one thing that you've got to be aware of. Another question that people often have is, you know, the hole on the side of the booster to let the air out. How big can you make it? Well, if you make it too big, as in the case of this rocket, what's going to happen is just that hot air, instead of being directed up into the nozzle, it's just going to find the path of least resistance, which is just out the side. So if you had something like this, this is not going to work for gap staging. And what the manufacturer of this kit did is they give you this little tube right here that you slide into here. And now, instead of the air coming out the side, it's got to go through the tube. And you can see I got my hole in there for the nozzle so that that cold air can still get out, but the hot air is directed up into the nozzle. So that's a neat little trick you can do if you have a big gap like this rocket right here. So this has been direct staging and gap staging. And we talked a little bit about indirect staging, but that's a topic for another video. In fact, if you're interested in that, we have a kit called the TTV, which stands for Timer Test Vehicle. And that is your training ground if you want to learn indirect staging. It does require electronics, you know, a separate battery and a separate ignition system in the upper stage, but we'll walk you through that entire process. Once you can do indirect staging, now you can do staging with high power rocket engines. And that's what the whole purpose is, to kind of train you in that process. So my name is Tim Van Milligan. This has been the Apogee Rocketry Workshop. May the winds be light, may the skies be blue, and may all your rockets fly straight and true.